Hi class, it's Bill with the continuation of the Chapter 6 intro video. In the first video, we talked about the bulk of the chapter and the file.io stuff, but the chapter also covers exceptions, and so we want to continue this, but focus really only on exceptions for this video. So let's jump forward and talk about those. The thing about exceptions, the reason that we care about this, many times when you're running the program, things go wrong during the execution of the program that halt the program, abort it, terminate it, blow it up, whatever you want to call it. Bad things happen, and when bad things happen that you don't expect, sometimes they blow up your program and you're done. You've lost whatever you were processing in the meantime, you've gotten, you know, sort of stuck at that point, and the user has to start again with whatever they were doing. None of us like crash programs and lost data. Now, there are ways around this. You don't have to use this particular theory. You know, in the past that we looked at strings and we looked at ways to say, is it a digit? Is it an uppercase? So, you know, you could write code that goes through and figures out all of this stuff and looks for very specific kinds of errors, but frankly, you're going to be doing that for a really long time. Sometimes it's useful, and sometimes you need to do it, and in some programs, exceptions just don't really work. There are some gigantic systems in which exceptions get very hard to deal with because of the number of functions and the interrelationship of how you have to pass these things around. But the general idea is very cool and very useful, so we want to look at it. And that is, we want to bulletproof our code to some extent at least by guarding against typical kinds of errors. Here are some typical ones. You ask the user for their age, but they type in the words 43 instead of the number 43. Well, that's going to blow up your program. Also, maybe you're looking for a file, you're trying to open a file, but the file doesn't exist. It's not there, or it has the wrong name. Your program will blow up. You'd like to give the user a chance to kind of fix that and then go on. Sometimes when you do operations that you think seem innocuous, like dividing a number by another number, if the second number is zero, it's going to blow up. So again, you could guard against this in code by checking if that second number is zero before you do the division, sure. But this is another way to do that, and so it's an interesting topic for us to look at. So here is the way that this looks. This is how the mechanism looks in code. So let's look at that here at the bottom of the page in the font, the monospaced font. First, you put the word try and a colon, and then indented, you list the thing or things that you're trying to do that you think are probably risky. You're going to open the file, for instance, or you're going to do the division, or you're going to do something that you think might be risky. Then, after that, you put except and you put a colon, or you put except and the exact error that you're trying to figure out, and then a colon. And then you put what you want to do, the code that you're trying to do to handle the problem. Then, optionally, you have two other clauses. One's called else, and that under that you put the stuff if you want to do only if the exceptions were, if no exceptions happened. So the else stuff is, okay, we're okay, nothing bad happened, so we can continue and do this stuff. And then there's also an optional finally clause at the very bottom, and you put stuff that you want to do there, whether or not there were exceptions. So sometimes you need to, for instance, close files or things like that. If something bad happened, you know, whatever, you still need to close the file before you could move on. So you can use these thoughtfully, but you certainly need try and except. Now, rather than try to express this in a series of just slides, I think it's more useful if you see the evolution of a program and we work through this together. So that's what I'm going to do next, is we're going to take a sample program that we have that does a very simple calculation, and then let's see if we can bulletproof it and sort of add additional value and end up with a routine that we're really proud of at the end. So here's the example. We are a simple program that asks the user for their age and then tells them how old they are in dog years. And there's a function called dog years which does the calculation. It just multiplies the human years that's provided as a parameter and multiplies it by 7. So this is really straightforward, right? It's a simple program. It should work. And if we run it, F5, and then I enter an age that is completely valid, like, 25, then it says it's 175 in dog years. Well, great. But what happens if the user types something bad in here? What if they type 20 instead? Well, it's going to blow up. Right, it blows up our program, it's done, the user can't continue, they don't know what to do, something bad happened. So we'd like to be able to give them an error message, we'd like to be able to tell them what to do to correct it, we'd like to give them another chance, etc. None of that happens with our current code. So let's see what we can do to use try and accept to try to figure this out. How does that work? Well, I obviously can focus on the main program. What is the thing that's risky? Well, the print statement is not particularly risky, but the user age business seems to be risky because the conversion from integer fails if they type in something bad. So the first attempt here is we just put try colon and then indented under that, as we do with all kinds of blocks here, we put the thing that we think might be risky. Then we need to have a second thing that says accept. Right? And under accept, we can just do this, and then we can give an error message. Print, please enter ages using only numbers. Since we think that's probably the thing that happened. So that could be our first attempt. Now, let's see if that works first. Let's save and let's run. Have I forgotten anything? I think that's good. Enter my age, 20. Okay, so something's not right here. Notice it's talking about user age referenced before assignment, and it's complaining about line 6 in main. Okay, so let's go to Alt G, line 6. That's an easy way to jump down here. Ah, look what's happening. I'm trying to print it in the case where it's not set, right? Because if that fails under the try, I print the error message, but then I go ahead and try to print the resulting thing anyway. So that's not quite what I want. What do I need? Well, I need the else clause, because I only want to do this stuff if there was not an error. So in this case, yes, the else clause is optional, but not in my case, because I need to do this only in that particular case. So try the thing that might be dangerous. Do this printing of the error message in case there's an exception, and then also after, if there was no error, then we do the print. Let's try it again, save, run. Okay, let's enter our age of 20. Please enter ages using only numbers. Okay, cool. So that gave me a, that was not too bad, right? That worked pretty well. Now, a couple things that we want to note here is this is very heavy-handed. The accept that we have here will catch any kind of error, and if it has nothing to do with them not entering numbers, they're still going to get this error message. So very often we want to be a little more specific, and you may have a series of accept clauses, each one catching a different type of error, so that you could be very specific with your error message, and you always want to tell the user not just that there was an error, but what they can do to fix it, and then give them a chance to fix it. So how do we find that? What do we know what to put here after the word accept? Well, let's go back to our example of, in fact, we can do this in various different ways, but let's just take a very simple example here. Let's just put this outside the try block to begin with. And I want to go back and do the wrong thing so you can see how to find the error. I'm going to press, I'm going to try to run that, and then I'm going to enter the age and type the wrong thing. Okay. Here's the key that I want you to see. At the bottom of this traceback, you notice what we get? This thing that says value error. Well, when you see a message like that, that is the exception. So if you just go and copy that to the clipboard, and then you come back here, now we can get rid of this, and then under accept, I can do this. Value error. Notice it's also a keyword. You see that it turns purple, or it's a constant that it understands. So basically, that will catch only that type of error where a value error exception is thrown. We will catch it here and we will act on it with this. Now, if we want to put some other generic thing, sometimes we'll say something like this, which says something else bad happened, unexpected error. Now, we wouldn't expect the user to ever see this. It doesn't tell them what to do. It's not very useful, but you might put something like this to just say, if you ever see this error, contact blah, 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 right? Let us know. Submit a help request or something, because you should not see this error. But that's a way to catch anything else bad that might happen. But let's get rid of that for now, just so you have a general idea. So our program's looking pretty good. Let's run it one more time to make sure everything's cool. 20. Oops, I pasted. I had something on the clipboard. And it says enter that using only numbers. Oops, let me get that back. Sorry about that. There we go. Okay, so it's working, but the user doesn't get a chance to fix it, right? They sort of get the error message and then they're out. So what are we going to do to evolve this program and be a little bit smarter about it? Well, obviously we need some sort of loop. And so I'm going to come out here. Where do I want to put the loop? Well, I need this whole thing in the loop, probably. So I'm going to say while, because I know it's going to be condition-based, right? They only get out once they do what I ask them to do. But where's the end of the loop? Well, let's think about this a little bit. I could put it here, right? I could indent all of this stuff. By the way, do you know how to do that? There's a format command that says indent region. It's control right square bracket. So that's kind of convenient. I can do that, but I think you'll see that something's going to be wrong with this because we only want to print the dog ears message if we are completely finished with all the data entry. So it needs to be kind of outside the guard. So you see what I'm about to do here? Take out the else and unindent, right? Now, I don't know yet what the while's supposed to be. How are we going to keep them trapped until they comply? Well, here's something that you might think of. Why don't I use some sort of sentinel, right? Why don't I use some sort of signal to myself? For instance, I create a variable that says valid user age equals false. And as long as they have not provided a valid user age, then I'm going to keep looping, right? That seems kind of reasonable. But then, how do they get a good valid age? Well, now I've got to go sort of back to my original thing and say else. I guess I do need that clause after all, valid user age equals true, right? Because only in the case where we did not get an exception do they get the valid user age true, right? That's when they've done the right thing, and then we let them out of the loop, and then we can print. So does that make sense? Stop, pause, look. Make sure that this makes sense. We're using our own little signal that lets us know we're done and we can move on. And then outside the loop, we know we're done and we can print the resulting message. So that seems right. I think that's good. Let's try it out. Let's do F5. Okay, enter your age, 20. Please enter ages only using numbers. Enter your age, 30. Well, okay, it doesn't believe me still. Enter my age. 29. Yay, that's 203 in dog years. Nice, right? So we've solved the problem of the having the loop to confine the user in there, keep them in there while we are working until they've done the thing that we're supposed to do, and it catches the error with an exception. So hopefully that makes sense. Now, the one thing that I looked at as I was gazing at this, thinking this was my final version, there's two things that bugged me. One is, I'm still not catching range errors on the numbers. So if they enter -5, I'm still proceeding to calculate dog years, and I probably don't want to do that, or an age of 130, unlikely. So I probably want to catch that. And then something bugged me about having to do this. This felt artificial in a way. So let's talk about how we might make solve that problem, and then we'll go back and make the final thing about the ranges. And actually this kind of solves them both together. Do I really need an extra variable, or can I use a variable that already exists? Well, the only variable I really have of interest is user age. Do I need a separate signal? Can I not just do something like this? All right? And then instead of not valid user age, I could say while user age is equal to, two equal signs, -99. Why don't I just loop while I still have 99, which is the seed value that I gave it up here, right? That's what I put in to get the loop started. As long as it's -99, that it should be fine, because notice, if there's an error, I take the except part, and then I don't need to do anything with valid age. In fact, I can completely get rid of this, right? So I don't need the signal, and that simplifies my code, because if they put in something that's not -99, or that's a bad value, it will never set the new value, so it'll still be 99, right? So as long as they don't comply, it's always going to be -99. Again, stop, think about that a little bit, see why that simplification just worked, right? If you believe it's a simplification. And now let's try it and see if we still have the same result. Let's make sure our code is still right. So try it. 20. Nope. 30. Nope. 30 in numbers. Yep, seems to work. So that may seem like a simplification. I certainly am using a variable, and I got rid of an else clause because my brain knows I can't have set user age to a good value if there was an exception. Now, last but not least, to achieve our final goal, what can we do? Well, we really kind of want to keep the user in the loop until they enter a good age, right? So why don't we do this? Instead of while age is not equal to or equal to 99, why don't we be a little bit more clever and say while the user age is less than 0 or user age is greater than 120. So we keep looping while we have bad ages, and we start with negative 99, which will certainly make sure we're in the loop, right, because it's an invalid age, and that's our signal that we use to indicate, you know, we have a starting value and we have a, you know, we have a problem. It's still going to stay negative 99 either way. So this loop will keep them in regardless of whether they type in something that generates the exception or if they type in something that's out of range. It still covers both cases. Again, pause, think about that to make sure your brain understands it. Now, let's run it and let's see if it actually does the right thing. Type in 20. Okay, nope, keeps coming back. 30, of course it comes back. Negative 5, it just asks again. 130, okay, better test values. Negative 1, 121. How about 0? Okay, that's 0 in dog ears. So it seems to do the thing that we want. The only thing that we may want to do is we may want to tell the user what the range is, 0 to 120. Just because if it keeps asking them, they may go, why are you doing that? So giving them this little extra hint, or we could certainly give them an error message in the case that it's out of range, that's a little different, but that's a simple way to do it. So I think this program now has reached its final elegance, and it's as concise as we can. I believe that solves the problem. So let's do one more round of testing. Range 1, okay, negative 5. 121. Negative 30. 30. Okay, it seems like it's doing the right thing in all the simple cases that we can try here. So while we have not prevented necessarily every error possibly that could happen when we were running this program, we certainly guarded against a couple of typical things, some range errors, and we've used exceptions to guard against some other kinds of errors like completely bad data that we can't convert to integers. So hopefully you've understood sort of the evolution of this, and if you'll go and watch this back and watch the evolution again of why we did each step and what happened when we ran the program, do this yourself if you like and try it out so that you get experience with exceptions. But hopefully that's a helpful piece to you to understand how exceptions work and how to use them in a real case. So that brings us to the end of the presentations on Chapter 6. Lots of good stuff in this chapter, lots of meaty stuff. Enjoy it. Let me know if you have any questions via forums or emails, and thanks for watching the video.